There it is. Yeah, baby. Fish on like Donkey Kong. What's up, everybody? Joe Simons like diamonds. We are here in Tampa Bay. Just got absolutely annihilated by a rainstorm. I don't know how we didn't see it coming.
It helps to check the radar, apparently.
Yeah, it does help to check smart fishing spots. So speaking of that, we found a spot. This is a little mangrove island that we had not fished before that happened to have a little oyster bar on it and also happened to have a bunch of snook. We already had a couple just right when we got here, came up and started chasing. Luke's got the Moonwalker topwater, and I got a little Slam Shaded 2.0. It's a small little snook, but I'm not going to be too picky after day. You know what's bad? When you get to the ramp where there's normally a bunch of guides and there are zero, as in there was not a single other vehicle except our boy Frank that we just met, who's in a kayak, and hopefully he fared better than we did in the boat going through that storm. But I digress. We found this spot, already got fish on, and we're just gonna kind of fish around it. So if you're watching, you can see that we got this little mangrove island. And on the other side of it is an oyster bar. There's been a lot of mullet around. Clearly some snook. Let's see if we can get one here on topwater.
Yeah, and what we'll be doing is just showing some strategy on just post-rainstorm fishing. This is early morning. We got hammered by that rainstorm, basically right as the sun was coming up. We were too wet to put the camera gear. We've already caught probably 4 or 5 snook. So they've been pretty aggressive. So we're basically just power fishing. We're moving fast. I've got a topwater, casting up near these mangroves. We have a really high tide, and there's something actually pretty big right there. Let's see what that is. Might just be a mullet school. But we have a really high tide, so these fish are pushed up into the mangroves. We're hearing a lot of pops, but most of the pops are going on up in the mangroves. So I'm trying to call them out with the topwater. Joe has this paddle tail rig weedless, and he's skipping it up underneath the mangroves. So we're just gonna be covering ground and trying to pick off as many fish as we can before the sun gets up.
And before the bugs get too worse. My goodness.
Yeah, bugs are really bad.
Golly, you'd think here we're supposed to be in fall. Is that what the calendar said? Jeez, just getting annihilated. There's mullet jumping everywhere. I mean, look at this though, guys. Oh boy, went a little too aggressive on that mangrove line. Popped it out once.
Yeah, so as far as looking for a good spot, if you can check out right here in this little, we have a little cove and some little mangrove shoots, and you can see just a lot of little ripples. Those are mullet. So we have a lot of mullet up on here, and they're getting chased around by something. And so I'm going to just take this topwater through these little shoots. This is a little oyster bar. We found this on Smart Fishing Spots. It has a little oyster layer on there, and it is awesome for finding spots that are likely to hold some predators.
You guys see that? Ooh, there is a ton. Oh, I just got a no see them in my eyeball.
So these fish are apparently holding right where that app was saying to go. Let's see if we can pick up more than just that one.
Yeah, so on Smart Fishing Spots, that's the app/software we have for all of our members. It actually has all the oyster bars, and we're adding more all the time. So we get that data. And it's so cool, because you can go to a brand new spot, in a brand new city, brand new state, and just hit the little layer that says oyster bars. Golly, I got that. No see them in my eyeball. And that's a great place to start, especially if you can have... Oh, did you guys hear that? Oysters and grass or a little ledge, maximize the structure, maximize the, oh, do you see that?
Yeah.
Oh, there's definitely some fish back here. You know what I think we need is a little Dr. Juice. That's what I'm missing on here.
Yeah, and as Joe was saying, to maximize structure. So in this case, we have the oysters right up here next to the mangroves, and there's a good amount of grass in this bay as well. So this is kind of a perfect situation where we have multiple forms of structure and we have the bait. So we have a lot of mullet up in here. And so not surprised at all that we picked off one snook. We actually had a nice one blow up right before the cameras turned on. So there's definitely fish here. And now it's just a matter of just trying to get a lure in front of them. Right now is the toughest time. Probably about 2 or 3 hours from now is going to be probably the best fishing, because that water is going to start falling out, and those fish are going to have to start pulling pulling out of these trees right now. It's just like a maximum high tide, and they have so much. Oop, I'm having one hit mine. They just have so much real estate.
So what I do as a good brother and good angler is go right behind him when he's got a.
It's still on me. It's a little guy.
Top water. Oh, there it is.
Ah, you rascal! That's a good one there. All right, so Joe's got a bigger fish. So he's going around that point. So I'm going to get the trolling motor as fast as I can. Put rod forward. Keep it down.
I'm trying to turn him.
Nice fish. Okay, good. He's way out there. Nice. Yeah, so we have this big mangrove point, so we just had to get away from that mangrove. This fish is going out. This might be a...
Could be a red, you think?
It's either a red or a really big snook.
Or a stingray.
So now we're in the clear.
That happened to me with Peter Deeks. I thought we were fighting this massive red and told him that would be a stingray. I'm not going to jinx myself here, but...
Yeah, so that's a big deal. When you're fishing near these mangroves, as soon as you're going to something big, get away from any structure as possible. Hopefully it's not a jack. It's kind of
I know it is kind of doing jacky.
I'm gonna start fishing up here then. But that one with Deeks, I thought it was a jack. Or it was a 45-inch snook.
Yeah,
snook
you never got. Know. You never know. It's definitely fighting like a jack.
Yeah. Oh no.
I don't know.
I still think it's a jack.
Yeah. Now he's circling back around. Well, still a fun fight either way here.
Oh, got the hopes up.
As I'm getting still annihilated by these.
So the fact that it was doing a circle one way and it switched to do a circle another way, I'll be surprised if that is not a jack.
Well, getting closer. Big old jack. Big old jack. Those things are so powerful though.
I think that's what came up on mine. I was reeling the topwater in real fast, going for the next cast, and something slammed me. That's probably what it was right there.
Oh, that would have been so much cooler if that was a big snook. Oh, come here, buddy. Don't go in the trolling motor. There we go. Turn his head up. Jack attack. So much power. There we go. Hold on, bud. Oh, and it snapped my line at the very end. Unbelievable. Oh, well, that couldn't have gone any worse. Not only did I have to fight a jack in this prime time area, I just lost.
Let that thing break you off?
Yeah, at the very end, I probably should have just pulled him up. But you guys learned from me. It's not the first time I've made a mistake bringing a fish in.
Yeah, so I just had a little snook pop me right here on this point. Joe had his lure ready. He could go in there and catch him. Because a lot of times they'll hit topwater, and very common for them to miss topwater. A lot of times they go up and just pop in the air. But that's just a good sign when you see them come up and hit. If you have somebody else with a subsurface, like a little, like what Joe just had on the Slam Shady 2.0, it's about the same size of this lure, but it's under the surface, and they just have a much easier time sucking those down. In that case, that was a little small snook, so I'm not too disappointed that it missed. The bigger ones will usually come up and suck it down and eat, and the smaller ones pop it and do a lot of misses. Oh, there's like just right there. Yeah, I saw that when it came out of the water for it.
I love that noise.
But a lot of times, those little small ones will cause that commotion. Oh, little smaller ones will cause that commotion, and the bigger one will come out and go up and slam it. So that's what I'm hoping will happen here. Make a couple more casts in this little pocket.
And talk about your the new rod here. Everyone loves talking about equipment. We're always testing out new stuff.
Yeah, so this is a rod from Cashin. It hasn't yet been released, but it will pretty soon. And so this is a Made in the USA rod. And the coolest thing about it is that they've been able to shave costs and now get a Made in the USA rod for under $150. I think it's like $140 or $130 range. And which I don't think has ever been done, at least not anytime recent. So really cool. I mean, Made in the USA rod.
Yeah, not for a legit inshore rod.
Yeah, this is very nice. I mean, pretty much all rods under like $300 are made overseas. and they've been able to make it happen. And this is my first time using it, and started off probably 3 or 4 snook deep, all on topwater. So that's a heck of a way to start it off.
No, it's not going to compete with our upcoming Made in USA slot machine.
Yeah, I mean,
but for $130, just for a great value rod, kind of like the TFO, right?
Yeah, it's similar to the TFO. A little bit. It's a little bit tip light compared to the TFO. The TFO medium.
Tip light.
Yeah, where it's just the TFO has a little bit stiffer tip. So my test with this is great for topwater. My ultimate test with it will be later today. I'm going to put on a Slam Shady Bomber on a Haas Helix hook, and if it can get those hook sets, if it's strong enough to get those hook sets, which it might be, it's going to be close. But if that's strong enough for those hook sets, then this could be one of my new favorite all-purpose rods, because I feel it's super lightweight. So it's definitely lighter than the TFO.
Holy stinking Jack Attack.
Back in business. So we're gonna go over, fish around that island. So now we're gonna go over, check these others out. I see some more mullet on this one, and there's a bunch of mullet over there too. And that is pretty much one of the better signs you could see for a spot that's gonna be holding some fish.
Yep, find the bait. That's one of the questions we ask all the time to any of our insider members, or even just friends who are out fishing in an area and they're not catching any fish, is, all right, tell us about the bait you saw. And if they didn't see anything, then typically one of the issues.
Or what structure you're fishing.
If they can't answer both of those confidently, then could be part of the issue. But right now, there's a lot of mullet around. And I was just on the East Coast last week with old Captain Peter Deke. Ooh,
ooh. Ooh. What was that?
I do not know. But I would cast over there. I don't know if I spooked up something or what, but that was a big old boil. But same thing over there on the East Coast. I mean, you know, they just kind of finishing up their mullet run. There's no lack of bait. And so given the choice, I would fish near it, because there's usually going to be some predators, whether it be a jack or a snook. Man, dude, I thought that was a big snook when that thing hit and started taking off. Oh, well.
Once it started doing the old circle, that's the sign. That's the jack sign.
And for a stingray, it's they just sit there at the bottom and you can't move them. I've also been there before. Brutal. Yeah, well, old Peter Deeks, I was telling Luke, we caught, I believe it was 12 or 13 slot and even some overslot snook. And he apologized for the slow day. That dude is just a machine. He catches some big fish. And I was like, nothing to apologize for, dude. That's a pretty epic day. And my buddy Kyle came with me. We both happened to be over there in Vero. And he never caught a snook before, and like you should have seen him. He was like, "What do I do?" It was awesome to see his face when he got that.
It is not bass fishing.
No, and that's all. He was more of a bass fisherman, and he's not used to having to use the rod. Ooh, hit there. That much for leverage. All right, there's definitely a couple fish back in there, Luke. I just got a good hit. Now, right here in between these two mangroves, this is a little choke point, if you will. I got a hit, so I'm going to try to see if I can get another one. You can see all the mullet. Man, that was nice.
Yeah, something just hit right there. That might have been mullet getting spooked, but either way.
Look at that point up there, all the mullet there. Mm-hmm. Golly, looks so good.
Yeah, so we're just keeping constant motion, just covering ground, and just trying to pick off as many spots close to these mangroves as we can.
Another little tip. And this depends on the area, but it's about making sure you don't reel in and kind of give up too quick. We've had two different times where we were reel in just to try to get in quickly to make another cast, and the snook hit right next to the boat. Sometimes they're just fired up and we'll follow it all the way up. We've had two of them. That one probably won't work when my tail gets hooked around the hook. So I'm back. If you're listening, I'm back to Slam Shady 2.0. It's kind of my confidence lure. And Luke's still going topwater. See if we can get some on this point. Always fish the points. That's how we started off this this morning. It was still dark and we were soaking wet. Is that the right word?
Yeah.
We're just absolutely drenched. Shoes are drenched. So we couldn't film at the time.
Yeah, that was a strike right there.
Hey. Oh, yeah, that deserves a strike there.
Yeah, this was like the one time I forgot my rain jacket too. I didn't bring it in there. I took it to Texas. I just got back, and I usually just keep it in the boat so I never can forget it. And because of that, I got about as wet as I possibly could. I could not have been any wetter if I just jumped in the water.
Oh,
that was a better fish there. There we are. Oh, the smaller one got it. There's a bigger one in there.
All right, let me get my line in and see if I can't find them.
Yeah, that was right on that point. We had the point with mullet, and then this topwater called them out there, and one of them was nice.
Always the case when you catch the small one.
Then this little guy came up and slammed it.
All right, so I'm going to stay on this point.
All right.
See if we can't do it. Little snooky.
Little fella. Let this guy go. All right, back at it.
Yeah, the old moonwalker. Do you guys use that much over in Texas?
Not much. We mostly throwing the bombers there. They're all over the bomber.
Showing you rods here behind. The bomber. On a Haas Helix?
You know it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because there's so much sawgrass there, the fish were holding tight to the sawgrass. There we are. Ooh,
that's a nicer one.
That might have been the one that I lost. Yeah, there's a bunch of sawgrass there, and those fish were holding tight to it. And so the bomber on the Helix hook was the best way to fish it.
Ooh. Mine's bigger.
Oh man, I'm caught in this stinking mangrove.
Oh boy. Oh, nice little snook there. Come on, baby, come on. Love that 2.0.
Nice work.
Love that 2.0. Come here, buddy. There we go.
Sweet.
Looking little snook there.
Getting bigger.
Come on. Sharp hook. All right. There you go, buddy. All right. Line still. Oh, you know what? I'm just going to, on the safe side, always check your line if you're catching a snook. Even the little small guys can do some damage. And what you don't want to do, which is probably another reason I lost that jack trying to pull him up. I'd already caught a snook on that and didn't replace it. And all it takes is that little bit of fray, and you can just see it all frayed up on the end.
What pound leader are you using?
This is 25. What do you got?
I go with 30. Or I did the old bite tippet where it's 20. 20 started leader for about maybe a foot, maybe 16 inches, I'd say, and then about 6 inches of 30 for the bite tippet. And right now, my moonwalker is in the tree. So I had this moonwalker in the tree, and then while Joe was fighting that snook, I had my other rod with the bomber, and I skipped up underneath there to see if there's any more fish before I totally ruined the spot. And
probably bring out every single bug in the area.
Yeah, I can't leave my moonwalker here. And now that the sun's coming up, I am going to be switching to the bomber. Yeah, this thing was not
good. And also good just for the environment to get your lures out of mangrove trees.
Yep. Come on. This thing didn't
did a
let
whole
go.
Podcast on that. And in terms of just leaving line and lures and birds that hang out in these trees. Always smart to get it.
Yep, so yeah, here's the Dirty Deeks. So you can just see what I'm talking about is that, there it is. So as that last 6 inches or so, it was longer, I've had to replace it after catching a couple snook. So 20 pound down to the 30. And that just makes sure that the business end right here that gets hit with the, by the snook, by the snook's mouth, that's protected. It's a big deal. To just as far as making sure that you don't get stuck.
Yeah, baby.
Hit that troll motor up.
Oh, come on, get him out on that mangroves.
Got him.
Yeah, baby. Another nice snook. There we go.
Fella.
Woo. Oh, Luke had just said he thought the spot was all blown out, but not when you got Slam Shady 2.0 and Dr. Juice. Yeah, baby. Come here. Come here. Come here. Oh, boy. I could be in the top 10 worst catch and release guys out there. There we go. Good little snooky. Here you go, bud. Watch them swim off right in front of you. And these things are so much fun. Probably would need a little bit heavier gear if we were going after some of those ones I was catching with Deeks. But using this little, I think I got, this is 8 pound braid. So I did listen to you, Luke. Luke was going down to 5. And I do feel like I'm getting more strikes when I went down to 8. Are you still using 5? What do you use?
I've got 10 now. I was doing 5 in the summer when everything was real spooky. Now these fish are getting more aggressive.
Actually, you know what? This is 10. The other one, that rod back there is the...
Oh, I was about to say, something was making some weird ruckus. It's a couple manatees.
Manatees?
Yeah, I was wondering what that was. I thought we had a school of reds.
Can you describe the ruckus, sir? Movie, Joel? Breakfast Club.
Breakfast Club, yeah. Classic.
Ooh, another hit there. Man, there's a lot of snook around this. Isn't that cool? I mean, just right here, just finding these random little mangrove lines, and all started with finding oysters on smart fishing spots. And then when you pull up to a spot like that and you see all that activity, all that mullet, you know there's fish around. You just got to be patient and just keep making casts, honestly. That's what we've already caught a few on just on the podcast. We already had 4 or 5 before that. Mm-hmm. All this one little,
they're feeding.
One little area.
Sometimes it helps to brave the storm.
Yeah, another cool thing with smart fishing spots, we talked about it on a prior podcast, but have some really cool stuff coming for everyone, obviously, but in particular, the nearshore, caught in a little mangrove tree, and offshore guys with this chlorophyll layers and the sea surface temps. So you actually see the temperature.
Oh, manatee's right there.
Well, look at that manatee, look. Please don't spook, don't spook.
I'm not turning the troll motor on.
Yeah.
Just to be sure.
We don't wanna.
The giant one literally like right under my rod tip right there.
We don't want to have me screaming. You see some of those videos where the guys in the kayaks just get annihilated.
Yeah, those things are powerful.
Yeah. If that thing gets spooked and slaps you with the tail, you flying. And they're loud too. I mean, it's just like, it looks like a bomb goes off underneath you in the water. All right, I can.
Let's see, I think swim off. I want to go back up in this little, right up here, there's a bunch of mullet up here in this little cove. Okay, yeah, there's the other manatee up there ahead. I think we're in the clear now.
Well, this looks good back here.
There's a bunch of bait up here.
There we go, mine in. Check my line one more time. Still weedless. Still weedless. Go right down the chute there. Look at all those mullet. Holy smokes. There's got to be some.
It's a good fish in here. So yeah, we don't have any wind. I usually like to have some wind chop. We have basically just dead calm right now. But those fish still seem to be pretty active. A lot of bait up on the surface. Looks pretty nervous.
No wind, lots of bugs.
Yeah, maybe we shouldn't go in there. That might be bug central there. I'll go on the outside. There's a bunch of little bait up on this side too.
Man, look at all this bait.
Yeah, we might get eaten alive if we go up in there. Ooh.
I just bumped a mullet. I get you excited. You feel like you just got a hit and like, you saw the mullet. Ooh, wow. Although there have been quite a few decent sized mullet caught on Slam Shady. Actually hit the hook. Not snagged. That's always funny when that happens. I say it's not easy to turn a vegan back into a carnivore, but it does happen.
Quite the feat.
It does happen, yep. Nothing against you vegans out there. God bless you and your healthy diets, but it ain't for me. Joel, ever go vegan? Ever try it? No? Luke?
Never.
Vegetarian? I did it for an afternoon, had salad.
It was the worst.
Yeah.
Still have nightmares.
Yeah. And all of a sudden, they told me there's no bacon on this salad. I about lost it. Like Chris Farley, when they're doing the blind, what was it?
Coffee crystals.
Yeah. Sir, did you know this is Folgers decaffeinated coffee crystals? What? Ooh, it hit there. There it is. There it is.
Nice,
oh,
round two.
Yeah. Oh, dang it. So I had a little snook on and he spit it.
Then I got on a mangrove again.
Oh boy. Godly.
Yeah.
So I'd say the 2.0 kind of winning right now. For the day.
It done.
Slam Shady 2.0, that is. Now we have all these talking to the team, like, man, we got so many different lures. We got Fred 2.0 and Gold Digger 2.0 all in that same mold, that scented 3.5-inch paddle tail. Got the new one, should be coming out in the next couple weeks.
Yep. Mulligan.
The Mulligan. If you don't know what I'm talking about, we did a whole podcast on it. And this is a brand new mold that we created from scratch and certainly unique, has the dimples kind of like a golf ball, which is why the name Mulligan. And it looks fantastic underwater. It looks like scales, the little dimples do. But the reason we, kind of modeled it after the golf ball is the dimples on a golf ball help the golf ball go about 50% further. And so we're like, well, hey, maybe it'll do it with a lure. And turns out it will cast further, but it also skips a whole lot better. You're taking some of that resistance there on the off the air resistance. We have to get a aerodynamic engineer. Some of my old friends from Georgia Tech.
Sometimes you got to be a little forceful to get it out of those windows.
I could just see that one coming at my face.
When but you do that,
yeah, this mulligan is pretty exciting, and we've obviously been testing it out for months and finally got the full production mold, and it is en route to start printing those suckers off. Ooh, see that boil?
That's a decent sized fish.
Yeah, it was. Yes, I'm pumped about the mulligan, and we'll probably start it. What are we starting in Slam Shady color?
Yeah, Slam Shady will be first. And then we'll eventually have all colors with it. But it is a
4-inch.
It is solid. Yeah, it's a
so
4-inch paddle tail.
Also giving us a 4-inch one, which has been highly requested.
And just in testing, and this was designed this way, but it's basically designed to be rigged on a weighted hook like we're doing now, but also to be rigged to be able to be used on a jig head. But with the weighted hook for covering the flats and for skipping up under mangroves and docks, is it casts further and skips better than any other 4-inch paddle tail. That was really the core prerequisite of the design in general.
Yep.
And in testing, it has absolutely held up to those two things. Because it's just purposely, it's pretty bulky. It's kind of like the bomber where it's pretty bulky. has a nice tail, and it flat out launches.
Skips well. And the cool thing, as I said, that we didn't even know until we started looking at underwater and in some videos, is how those little dimples look just like scales. It'd help you get more strikes per cast. The name of the game. So be looking for the Mulligan at fishstrong.com. That is our online tackle store, if you guys don't know. Of course, Insider members save 20% or more. We have some other cool stuff here for 2023, which will be here before you know it. Some new products, loyalty rewards program, which we're really pumped about. That's going to open up a lot of doors for you guys in terms of getting more and more stuff from us, your favorite friends here at Salt Strong and Fish Strong. And that'll be announced in January of 2023, loyalty rewards program, just to make it even more irresistible to buy things from our store. And of course, we'll have our physical tackle store at some point in 2023. It's had a lot of damage that we obviously were not expecting from the hurricane. Slowed things down a bit, but we won't give up. We will keep persevering. And
it's gonna happen.
Yeah, and it's, you know, it just made it where we were on the fence about kind of gutting the whole thing anyways, and that made it an easy decision.
Now we're forced to go.
The roof lifted up 6 inches, and the wind obviously was just pounding that all night long. So you got the roof, the building, 6-inch gap, and then wind and rain going in, so it was flooded. I mean, there's a foot or two of water inside the place the next morning.
Foot or two or inch or two? I don't think it was a foot.
It was 2 feet over in those offices. You can see the water line.
Dang.
Gnarly. Fortunately, like I said, you know, we didn't have anything of ours in there yet. And we were going to be doing some renovations anyway. So now we're just doing more of them. And that'll be really cool for all you guys to come. We'll start having some parties. It's on the water, so it's on a lake, so we can demo things and have events, get some kids fishing up there. It's gonna be really cool. What do you think? We fish this corner and maybe call this a podcast and move on?
Yeah, I'll move out. I'm not seeing nearly as much life, so I was gonna move out to a little cut where there's gonna be some more moving water.
Ooh.
That's a decent, we're gonna have to put the big motor down and go, there you are.
Ooh.
See if I can steal that from you.
Man.
You stole enough of my fish today.
Yeah, I took a swipe at it, and
we get right on the point, right? Not a surprise
right on
that
the
we
point.
Got a hit there.
Fish the points, guys. And to Luke's point, if you come up to an area that you're not seeing bait now, and after seeing all that bait, then you know what? Don't feel like you gotta sit there too long. Make a few casts, and then we bolt, like Michael Bolton, no talent boot clown. All kinds of movies coming in. Office Space. Joel, do you know that one?
Yeah.
Michael Bolton.
Ooh, I heard something big just strike up ahead. There's still some fish around.
Yep. All right, cool. We'll end it here. And of course, for you Insider members, we'll always put these reports in the community. And if you don't know, we have our own private community. It's not just the blog page. It's community.saltstrong.com. That's where myself, Luke, all the fishing coaches are hanging out every single day, posting our reports, posting exactly where we were on places like this. And that's also one of the access points to Smart Fishing Spots. That is our software/app that will literally give you everything you could possibly need to know to maximize your trips, including showing you actually where to fish based on all of the different trends that we are having come in to that app about every 15 minutes is updating. Really, really cool. So appreciate you guys big time. If you haven't joined the club, what the heck are you waiting on? Join us today at saltstrong.com. Save time, save money on your tackle, and be part of just a really cool, helpful community with anglers of all types. Right? I mean, we have, I'd say the majority are kind of the weekend warriors, and we have newbies who are just getting into it, and we even have full-time guides who pay the full amount just because they want to learn and they want to have access to some of the discounts. And heck, for them, they also get some good referrals because the guides who are in there who are helpful in sharing in the community are getting more bookings, right? If more of our members saying, hey, I'm in that area, I'm seeing a fish over here. I kind of want to hire that guy. He's been so nice and helpful. I feel like I know him. So that's been really cool to see that as well. But other than that, guys, make sure to go to saltstorm.com. We'll put this, if you're watching it on YouTube or listening, we'll have the actual video so you can see all these shenanigans and see the types of places that we're talking about. And that'll all be there at saltstrong.com. And it's also a place at the bottom where you can ask us questions. So, man, this now we're starting to see bait again. Now this is looking good.
Yeah, it's another little point here. This looks solid.
Let's see. I'm going to give one more cast here and see if I can catch them on this. Always fish the points. Always fish the points. All right, well, that might be it. We out. Slam Shady out. And we'll talk to you guys in the next podcast. Peace.
See you.